All right, I know you can hear me. I'm still having fun with you, though. Did you connect your internal mic, Tammy, up at the top for source, where it says select microphone by the microphone? And it's the internal microphone you probably need. Check your microphone now and see what you get. Oh, well, when worst comes to worst, you know what we can always do? Okay. What we can always do is I can play with you on the phone if you need be. You know what I mean? All right. Okay, and I'm just going to keep this connected to my ear so I can hear you. Okay, sounds good. All right, so if the people who are there, I'd love to get started. So I'm not sure how we're going to work this from your end, but I believe there is somebody who will be introducing us, Tammy. Okay. We're ready to roll, are we? Okay, well, good morning, everyone. I apologize for the technology funds that we're having, but hey, everybody knows about technology because we run into it every day in our classrooms and start working. We've decided to do something a little different this year, as I quite often will with Rural Congress. I end up dealing with doing some strange and wonderful things. And so this time we thought we'd come up with an interactive program between Tammy and myself, Tammy being right there with you. And then myself, I'm located out in Kimberley, British Columbia, coming in to do this presentation. We're recording the presentation, so it is available at any time. It is fully interactive, which means you can talk with Tammy, or there's a chat bar in the bottom right-hand corner of the screen where we can always enter things and I can always be reading and looking at the same time. So I'm Randy McLeod, the Education Manager with the Canadian Wildlife Federation. And with you should have Ms. Tammy Riel, the principal of the Cando Community School in Saskatchewan there as well. And we're ready to rock and roll since we're here about human-powered conservation. So the first thing we're going to do is give you a rough definition, and we're going to start moving quickly through things and spend some time as we move forward. Human-powered, the act of using human muscle. Walk, run, swim, push, pull, all these great things. But if you notice, I stuck a new one in there, the word row. Row, cycling, etc., under the new definition of human powered, is anything that is non-mechanized. So riding a bicycle is human powered because you are directly moving things. Unlike a car where I push down the accelerator, I am not physically moving the car, it's attached to something that does move the vehicle. Conservation. Most of us have a very good definition of what conservation is. It is the protection and or restoration of various things. Just examples, this is human power because these are sailboats, and sailboats typically that are race on the ocean do not have motors. They run completely on wind. Whoops, pardon me. Oh, we're having fun already. Cycling. A young lady who cycled across the country. Now then, we're sitting on other forms. We have the Great Canadian Turtle Race where we had turtles. Oh, now we're really going to have, just give me 2 seconds. It looks like the machine finally let me kick in. All right, human powered. That looks like a beautiful place for some human powered activities to take place. A rowboat, transatlantic row, and those of you that have been with us in the past realize that Orr Northwest and the four young gentlemen were rowing across the Atlantic Ocean, human powered. I always have to throw in their mascot, T-Rex. And of course, down on the bottom, if you notice the gentleman in the corner, and it is a gentleman, sorry ladies, at this point his partner is female, he is tagging great white sharks and is doing it without the aid of anything for his breathing capacity. He is a free diver. Then we have Miss Angela Gorin, who some of you may have met last year, who was cycling across Canada. And of course, we know cycling is a human-powered conservation. Of course, camping is all human-powered because if we're off the grid normally, we're set that way. We then have this last one where we were just going from there, and now we're going to move. And now, Tammy, I need you to take over because at this point here, human power is inspirational. I was watching another video today around human powered, and I know with the inspiration that your students that you probably have there are ready to rock and roll and can get rolling on things. So I'm going to turn it over to you for the next few moments. No problem. Yep, we're just rolling and I believe now, Tammy, we have a short video for them. Okay, give me a second. I'm just going to readjust everything, okay? This will only take me a moment. I'm going to re-alter things. Let me know if it starts showing. Thank you. All right, if that's going to keep on moving. Wonderful video, you and your students, and just a joy to see that in print. Just continuing on for a few minutes, as I do know we are under a bit of a time crunch thanks to the fun having. Last year, the Aurora Northwest boys, we talked about them with the Salish, which was an adventure around Vancouver Island as a preliminary row to go across the Americas from Senegal to Miami. And these links on here are sites that are here. But this year, meaning just last year, September to December range, the boys decided to do something a little different. They decided to do a Mississippi adventure. Now, the boys forgot a couple things in the Mississippi adventure, one of which is that the Mississippi actually does begin in Canada, and it does begin somewhere just around Winnipeg or the area up in there. And so what they did was they decided to take a 90-day road down the Mississippi River. And people say, well, that's really nice and wonderful that they can do that and they have the time. But while the boys were doing that, they were also doing scientific experimentation. They were collecting water samples. They were talking to schools. They were looking for garbage and debris that were within the Mississippi River. And those of us that have incredible Canadian history behind us all know that the Mississippi is part of the Louisiana Purchase that the American, the U.S. government had picked up from Canada back in the 1800s. So we have a direct connection here to this one. It all leads itself to the beauty that it is one of Canada's top flyways and watershed areas completely within North America. But while the boys were doing that, they were also out, and here we go with the connection. They were putting together some major education components dealing with all of this, and people actually started to get involved with this. So they had educational models put together for teachers and students to work with, and they were playing with them the whole time. They were going over how you could track the crew, how you could do things. The site I've just currently thrown up here for you was a parcel of their ocean one. But again, most of this came along. The boats were a little different this time. The history is a little different, but the history of the Mississippi is phenomenal. They started dealing with science and activities. And so lots of things transpired while they were on their trek up and down the Mississippi River. Identifying various things along the shorelines where they were many shells that were there, the incredible wildlife and other things that were taking place, eagles up in trees, and of course they always had fun because they were in small boats going through the canals and all the way up, which led off to another complete and total adventure to work with. So another scenario to work from human powered and how we can do it. To get a small idea around this, Jordan, who was the captain of the ocean row, was also the captain of this one. Jordan is out of Seattle, and Max Finkelstein, who was with them, introduced them to a number of things, one of which was bannock that Jordan had never tasted in his life, and quite interested in their camping procedures. They actually did live off the land for a little bit of time. Another person who we've got who deals with an awful lot of Howard scenario and is also from another education component, Mr. William Winram, who is now the Guinness record for free diving, a wonderful Canadian gentleman. He has now turned his free diving into tagging of sharks. I know an interesting scenario there, that we're going to tag sharks. He is doing it with a series of other divers through the Waterman Project, which should be there for you. He finds it quite interesting, so do I, that I asked him a question while he was giving a presentation day. I said, how do you tag a shark? Do you stand back, aim at them, do whatever? He says, no, it's quite simple. You jump in the water and you swim with them. And I'm going, okay, you're going to swim with sharks. Like, you must be a little bit of a... No, Well, I actually swim right up, get beside them, and look them in the eye. He says, you can look the shark in the eye and there's no bubble thing. Then what is happening is they just think you're with what's normal there. And they leave you alone. And I said, well, that seems more like you're trying to lunch up on a free basis for them. He says, no, not too shabby. And it all works. And then they tag them. And now we're starting to get all kinds of information about sharks, roaming patterns, how far they go. Again, nice pieces of conservation, because at the current time, sharks in a lot of cases are on a decline. As a matter of fact, today I was out on the site, and for the first time, they have actually seen a 6 meter or 20 foot long female great white shark, which completely caught them off guard, because they were not anticipating seeing a shark of this nature. And he said it was probably the most beautiful sight he'd ever seen from under the water. So we're starting to talk and get all these great and incredible things, and we get William to do webinars very similar to these as well. Hopefully we haven't here. There we go. Another person that we do a lot of work with now, which is Mr. Damien Foxhall, and he is a world-class sailor. All right, a lot of people don't understand what it is, because in Canada, it's not something that we deal with, although I know in Saskatchewan, you know, the river up there, great for these huge sailboats, and we're all experts in sailing. But Damien is a world-class, and we call him a rock star in the world, because in Europe, he is very well known being a world record holder and champion of these. He is currently in leg five of the Volvo World Cup. Leg five, for most of us, means absolutely nothing, except for the fact that he is currently in transit from New Zealand to Brazil in a race. And a photo finish in this race is anything that happens after an hour at the finish line. They actually go back and revolve. What was happening was today we were out online and we've just discovered, and here we go with the beauty of technology, the vessel that he's on, the Dongfeng, has just had its mast broken in the middle of the South Atlantic, Pacific. They're chasing across just north of the Antarctic, across the most open and charted waters anywhere in the world, and they've had a mast break. Now, how it affect them? It's in order for them to compete in this race and continue going along, they're going to have this mast, have to get it fixed, and then continue along. Could set them back, or it may just put them out of the race. Here we are, live feeds from on the water, what's going on. Live experiential learning that is very wonderful, all around conservation and human power. Now, how can we utilize this? This is incredible stuff for the classroom to start working, showing what is going on and how they deal with it. Damien also, in the process, has been working with best practices on the water, how to take care of things. And just so you can see, there is actually a face that goes with this name. And hopefully it will pop up in just a moment as we're playing with internet connections. And we have that wonderful boost spinning wheel going on. Here we go. There he is right there, a wonderful Irish gentleman who's married a beautiful French Canadian. He lives just outside of Quebec City, but he probably spends a third of his time on the water, sailing around the world, educating youth over how to work with boats and various components such as that. We've just found out in the last month or so that he's working with a gentleman from New Carlisle High School out on the Gaspé. And they are actually building boats, which we're hoping to have sailing with them in June. And we're running webinars along that as to how the build is going and how things all work out for them. So continuing along that process, this is the Volvo Cup. And it just gives you an idea how they do it and what he's seeing. So now from an educational standpoint, what did he see? 26 sea snakes in less than 2 hours. What does a sea snake look like? Great little research project as to what goes on. pilot whales. He's seeing all of these incredible things while he's out there. But if you noticed on the last one, we now have a small oil slick, which was probably never entered anywhere in the world or made it into the news with anybody whatsoever. So they're starting to see things because these boats are out there on the habitat of the animals and wildlife that live in the water. And they're seeing things and starting to report it. And this way here, starting to make the waters a better way. Max Steen, who I mentioned a couple of years ago, meaning last year, decided he was going to do a row in a First Nations war canoe from Ottawa to Washington, D.C. And the trip is highlighted there, and he spent days on the water with people, again, talking, educating, working with students, and going through all the process. Then we have an incredible young company that is referred to as Ten Tree Apparel. The boys at Ten Tree, and there are three of them are sitting right there, sort of staring at you in the left hand, are all conservation-minded, working with sustainability. Currently, Derek in the blue shirt in that lower picture and David in the green shirt are in Nepal right now planting trees because for every piece of apparel, ergo their name, they plant 10 trees somewhere in the world. And now people are able to put that down on paper as to where they would like them to plant, how they would like to do it. Where are they located? Hate to tell you, they're in the other city, Regina. And again, marvelous business, and again, great things to work from. Angela Gorin, an incredible young athlete who, prior to coming on board with us, was trying to get into the Olympic rower, had a minor accident, and didn't make the 2008 or the 2004 Olympic. We've just discovered that Angela now has decided she is going to move on to the next Olympics and actually has her tryouts coming up shortly. And of course, yes, what will Angela be? She will be cycling. She spent 72 days going from Victoria to Halifax on a cycle, and all along the way, she was stopping at schools, talking with youth, talking about them getting outdoors, explaining how we need to do things and to take better care of what's going on. Along with that, well, what else would we do? Educate activities, building bird feeders. Okay, this is just one example of what we were doing and what Angela would be talking about. Building bird feeders out of plastic, so instead of throwing them away, recycle or put them in something else. Simple activity that can be done in classrooms, and anybody and everybody can get involved in it. Next up are our summer institutes, and this is a PD session for teachers, and the lucky pleasure I have is working with Tammy Rail, and Tammy was one of our participants last year. And at this point here, Tammy, I'm going to sort of let you have a handle here so you can talk about the incredible summer institutes that you had. The top right-hand corner was one I was on in May of 2013. And if you notice, I said May. As a matter of fact, it was May 27th of 2013. And that is us on the ice floe doing some teacher PD. And we are 3.5 hours out from Iqaluit in Frobisher Bay, literally living and doing everything on the land. The other picture that is there is the beautiful St. Mary's Falls that is located out here in the East Kootenays where I preside. So Tammy, can I turn it over to you now for a little while, and I'll control and play if you want. Okay. All right, Dan. What I was just doing there while Tammy was having a chat was just to go over a few things, showing you some of the ideas. I know Tammy had a great time in Tofino. This year we're going to be in the East Kootenays, and for those of you geographically looking at it, that will be areas, and some of you will understand some of the names and some of you won't. Fernie, British Columbia, will be dealing from Fernie all the way over through Cranbrook, Creston, up to Crawford Bay, into Kimberley, British Columbia, and dealing with various components and activities that take place here. These are all highlighted in webinars, and our webinars are free of charge. We take care of things, we talk. In the top right-hand corner, you've got Ken Beattie, Canada's favorite gardener, who talks about putting together outdoor gardens, flower beds, raised things for youth to work in, pizza gardens, and so forth and so forth. If you notice me looking away periodically, I'm just checking the clock to see where we are time-wise, because I don't wish to keep you too long, but again, to enjoy and see what's available. Programs, National Wildlife Week, for those of you I know in Saskatchewan, you were out on Easter break, as it is scheduled to happen between April 5th and April 11th. So we know you will not be available for that. We have a Wild About Sports program, which is a phenomenal program which Mr. Damien Foxhall is working with, and he's putting it all together. Wild Education is something some of you will be familiar with. This is our Project Wild and Below Zero programs that we happen to work with. And these are, again, professional development opportunities. You will then go through various things and activities. The Wild Education design for outdoors and set up in such a way for students involved and teachers. The idea is to get everybody involved outdoors, and we don't require a lot of things to deal with this. Some of you may already have been through our Project Wild and Below Zero training sessions. Something new this year is our Wild Migration Map, and the Wild Migration Map is making a tour across Canada. It'll be leaving Halifax on April the, pardon, be in Halifax on April the 6th, and then will make its way across the country. And I believe Tammy has got it coming into her school sometime. I believe it is Tammy in September, if I remember. And the Wild Migration Map is all about getting students and educators on the map, a gym-size map where there are activities to deal with, things to act with, going over migratory patterns, species at risk, watersheds, and a whole series of activities that can be done. There are 10 activities that we work with, and these activities have been put together, they're vetted completely. They were put together by educators, as everything we have is normally done. It's all done and then put through the process. And again, thanks to the time zones, there we go. The Wild Mike map, and just so you can see, that is roughly what it's like, and you can see the size, 35 by 26. And going over, where has that been? Well, currently it is in those various locations, and it is starting to make its way back, but these are our launch sites and checking it out and going for. So please check into it. We're booked pretty much solid through 2015, beginning of 2016. A map will be available after all that, and we encourage people to sign up. It's great. It comes with everything for you. It's again offered free to educators. Try into your schools and let you hold to it for a week or two or three. Go over it all and how it ties in. In some cases, you can even pick time of the year that you would like it in the building and how it can function. And in a case like that, we then send you instructions on how to move it to place. And again, we do not make you pay for any of that. It's set up very nicely for you. Then we go along and National Wildlife Week. And Tammy, this is yours again, because this is something that your students have put together to play with. And again, it's anything that can be done. I'm not sure if you wanted to talk about it for a moment or two, Tammy, or whether you just want to, this is good enough to play. Okay. Other programs we've got on the go: Pedagogies, Wild About Gardening, Habitat 2020, an array of various things that we can play with. Partners, well, we have the College of the Rockies. And okay. Okay, bye.